Hello, welcome to the Friday, February 23rd, 2018 edition of the Sands and Storm Center's Stormcast. My name is Johannes Ulrich, and today I'm recording from Jacksonville, Florida. You may remember that Intel had a difficult time with some of the microcode patches it released to combat the Spectre vulnerability and had to withdraw some of these updates. Well, earlier this week, Intel did release yet another update that will hopefully work this time. It has been released to OEMs. You cannot install this update directly. You have to wait for an update from your motherboard or computer's manufacturer. So it may take a little while for them to actually show up. At this point, I haven't heard about any problems with this second set of patches, but likely people are a little bit more careful this time, and it may take a while for them to actually apply these patches. But Intel isn't the only one having problems with patches. If you're using Node.js, you're probably familiar with NPM. NPM is a packet manager for JavaScript, and it is used to install and update packages, in particular if you're using Node.js. Well, version 5.7.0 of NPM, which was released a day or so ago, apparently did change permissions on, for example, the /etc directory on some systems. Now, there were a number of dependencies here. You actually had to be running npm at next, and you had to be running it as root in order for these changes to become effective. But if you were affected by this particular bug, then your system was pretty much rendered unbootable. The very latest version, version 5.7.1, released on Thursday morning, fixes this particular problem. So if possible, try to just skip 5.7.0. Also depends on the operating system you're running. Looks like FreeBSD was most affected by this particular problem. And Recorded Future has an interesting paper that does reveal some details about why we're seeing so many more malware samples with valid code signing signatures. According to this paper that was published by Recorded Future, these certificates were not actually created using stolen credentials. There was always sort of the assumption that someone gets a hold of code signing certificates, secret keys from a reputable company, and then uses them to sign malware. Instead, what Recorded Future found was it's much cheaper and in some ways easier for the bad guys to actually fool the certificate authorities. What's typically happening here is that the bad guys are registering companies with names that are resembling valid, well-known entities, and then they're using those corporate papers to then have certificate authorities issue them these bad certificates. So what this really comes down to is a similar problem that we have seen with TLS certificates, that really certificate authorities and the human, the social part here, is the actual vulnerability, that this really isn't so much about bad algorithms or bad practices, how these certificates are being handled at the entities that own them, but instead it's just too easy to actually obtain a certificate, and certificate authorities have a real hard time validating who is asking for this certificate. And yes, the bad guys still have to put out some money, so that's why you don't see more of this, but really all they do is they pay the normal retail price for these certificates. It's not that they somehow have to buy valid certificates on the black market. And talking about certificates and the like, if you remember a month or so ago, I tried to turn off TLS version 1.0 from the Internet Storm Center website. This podcast was actually one reason why we still left TLS 1.0 enabled. The main complaint that we got was from people with podcast software that all of a sudden was no longer able to retrieve our feed. Now, I looked at our statistics again earlier today, and it looked like about 2,000 or so different IP addresses a day are still using TLS 1.0 to connect to our Internet Storm Center website. I'm very much split at this point whether or not I should turn off TLS 1.0, but really would like to because the rest of the SANS infrastructure is turning it off for PCI reasons. And I did some sampling of the IP addresses that still are using TLS 1.0. A large number of that were scripts that are retrieving some of our data. So if you are running a script like this, double check and, well, use in your SSL library that's able to handle TLS 1.1 and 1.2, which probably will be the only TLS versions we'll be supporting within the next month or so. Well, and that's it for today. So thanks for listening and talk to you again on Monday. Bye.